So when I heard the word Michigan, the first thing I thought of was Wolverines. Well, I used to live in Michigan, and I'm an Ohio State fan, and then a little two-sentence poem they like to quote to me, "Oh, how I hate Ohio State." So it's such a welcoming place for me to be, you know. That's what came to mind immediately. So now I'm going to ask you a word, and I want you to really think hard on this. Think what day this is, what day this is, how we're all gathered together, and what do you think of when I say the word fathers?
Getting peace with
submitting to God's will. And just like you and me at times, get in, and this is baseball season, get involved. Now, the batter didn't get first base, but he balked, and he said, I'm just going to put a fleece out here, and we'll see if this works. It gets me off the hook. Let me try that again. Still didn't get me off the hook. And so Gideon knows he's got to follow God's will. And so he gathers that army like God told him to do. That was something he had to do. God didn't say, stand here, Gideon, we're going to bring you an army. He had to do, you see, as God leads, we follow. He's helping us become. And then when he gets the passing army, what looks passing, God says, ah, there's power in weakness. So he gets rid of all but 300 men. And I like the verse where Paul says, most gladly will I rather glory my weaknesses that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And Gideon's learning that lesson. And then you start to move into the battle itself. Before that, there's that scene where he goes down to the tent. And what an important part of our Christian life is we're developing is worship. And I want to make, I call it the first camp meeting worship scene. The third day, bow my tent. And it's like, wow, can you hear that? And then it's like praising God. Probably in a very quiet way, you know. They probably didn't strike the band, get the praise team out there, but quietly. Like that. And then they sneak out of the camp, and now they're ready, and they actually get into the Bible, into the battle. But see what we sometimes fail to understand about that battle are the stages of the victory. Because so often, here's what we think. And what we think is true, just incomplete. Gideon's got his 300. He says, guys, pick up a torch, pick up a pot. Now, some things you put the pots on top of the torches. So when they held them up and they broke them, there was that noise, and all of a sudden, when the oxygen hit those torches, there was actually a flare. And then for the people there now hearing 300 trumpets too, it's not like one army, it's like 300 battalions, maybe, in our words today, coming down on them. And it's just this shock, late at night, close to midnight, all of a sudden crashing pottery, pottery can make a lot of noise, flaming lights all over the place, trumpets all over the place, and the battle's on, and we're like, yes, Gideon defeated the Midianites. But that's not the end of the story. And we come to this next part in the lesson of what we learned from Gideon that applied to us. Is in these stages of victory, we learn about how God helps us become the person he wants us to be, and that includes having the perseverance we need to follow through on what God wants us to become. And when we take our Bibles and we go to Judges chapter 7, and we start reading in verse 22, that's where we're going to find the familiar part. If you turn in your Bibles, or in your phone, or your iPad, whatever, if you're using my Bible, page 210, that'll help you get right there, right? But when you come to verse 22, here's what it says. When the 300 trumpets sounded, the Lord caused, did you hear that? The Lord caused, remember what I said about following God, he leads, we follow. The Lord caused the men throughout the camp to turn on each other with their swords. The army fled to Beth-Shittah toward Zerah, as far as the border of Abel, Mahalah, near Tabath. Israelites from Naphtali, Asher, and all Manasseh were called out, and they pursued the Midianites. And Gideon sent messengers throughout the hill country of Ephraim, saying, come down against the Midianites and seize the waters of Jordan ahead of them as far as Beth Marah. So now we're starting to find more things happening here. In the first few verses there, verses 19 through 22, it's 300 versus 135,000. In verse 24, you see the fords of Jordan are seen. Now, we do have a river near here, and we have bridges, but some people understand when you say fords, we're not talking about the equipment they use to move the camels out. All right? It's just those shallow areas where the army could walk across the stream, and that was very significant because the river was like, you know, it was like a wall for them. But where the forts were, that's where then the enemy could come in. And so the men of Ephraim come and they capture that. And not only that, they capture two of the four Midianite leaders, Oreb the Raven and Zeke the Wolf. I really looked at those names and I think you probably picked them out because they were the two wearing black leather the motorcycle jackets. But they kind of sound like that, you know, Oreb the Raven, Zeke the Wolf. And they capture them all. But as they sometimes say on TV commercials, but wait, there's more. And I want you to go down to chapter up the pursuit, came to the Jerusalem, to the Jordan, and crossed it. You see, 15,000 of the Midianites had escaped. 135,000, 120 didn't make it. 15,000 had escaped. Two of the leaders didn't make it. Two others didn't make it across the river. And now we can find it. They're across the river, and Gideon didn't stop. See, at that point, if we were filming this today, we'd have Gideon standing on the river, singing this song, hit the road, Midianites, don't come back no more, no more, no more, right? That's kind of like the thing it is. And that wasn't the way it was. No happy songs, and yeah, just hit the road, don't come back no more. Gideon looked at his 300 men, and he said, we're not done. We're not done. And there were three things that did not top Gideon. And those three things should not stop us from becoming the people that God wants us to be. The first thing that should not stop us is success. Let's keep looking down into this passage, and we see the list of Gideon's successes. So he routed the enemy, and then he successfully recruits more army. He sends the word out to these tribes of Israel and also to Ephraim, another one of the tribes of Israel, and says, I need your help now. And it's amazing, isn't it, how fast they were a rapid response group to be there so fast. But my wonderment, every now and then I have theological wonderments, I can't prove it, but I think about when he started out and it was like just 300 men, he had all those other men that had been willing to fight, and they're back heading toward the goal. And then they get the word, we need you now. They were probably primed for being in battle. And they may have been even a little disappointed that they weren't getting an opportunity to take it out on the Midianites. And they said, you want us? We're in. We're in. And they showed up. And they showed up and joined in that fight. And Ephraim comes and captures the ford, Jordan. And so he routed the enemy and he recruited more. And he got the Midianites out of the land. And then he crosses over the Jordan with his 300. And look what we find in chapter 8, verses 10 through 12. Now Zeba and Zalmunna were in Karkor with a force of about 15,000 men, all that were left of the armies of the eastern trading peoples. 120,000 swordsmen had followed. Gideon went up by the route of the nomads east of Nobah and Jogbehah. You all know where that is. There's a Krispy Kreme there. And attacked the attacked the unsuspecting army. See, they didn't think. They thought, we're so far out in the desert, we're safe. We're just going to crash here. Zeba and Zalmunna, the two kings of Midian, fled, but he pursued them and captured them, routing the entire army. It wasn't enough just to get them out of the land. He wanted to make sure this was dealt with completely and follows them all the way out into the desert. And there, he captures the Midianite leaders. Now, the amazing thing is putting this all together. Yeah, this is the amazing thing. See, the battle started about midnight. So they had to move into position sometimes before midnight. The battle starts at midnight, and away it goes. And now you can't get from midnight to 6 a.m. to where these kings are out in the desert. So we've got to go a full another day because they're out there now, they're sleeping. And they're not ready thinking that Gideon's going to follow them all the way out there. So we're now up to about a 36-hour battle. And then you think about the fact that they have that battle and then they travel back and there's some more conflicts they deal with. This battle of Gideon's lasted longer than breaking a pot, holding up a torch, and blowing a horn. It may have lasted 48 to 60 hours. See the words, weary, yet pursuing? You know, it takes less faith to stop with success than to go on to the next chapter. I'll tell you, it's real today. Churches get comfortable, you know that? Churches get comfortable. They kind of get to the point where they feel like, hey, you know, we've got the building, hey, we've got people in the building, hey, we're doing all right. And they just kind of go into this cruise mold and lose the fact that their chief mission is joining the that fully devoted follower. I want you to go from being a baby in Christ to a mature believer in Christ, one who is rooted and grounded and built up in the faith. And this process, don't stall out and go and say, hey, I'm feeling pretty good now. God says there's more you can do. So success didn't stop giving. The success in our life of development as a follower of Christ shouldn't stop either. Look, I'm older than a lot of people. I know that. And I know God used it in my life. I trusted Christ when I was probably about first grade. I still remember that night very clearly. I believe God called me into the ministry when I was like in second grade. That's kind of weird, but my neighbor took me to an ordination council. Who does that to us for a second grader? But I came home from that to that since that's what God wanted me to do. And you know, here I am standing here decades later. And Dennis and I have been having some interesting conversations about one particular verse of the Bible. And I said to him the other day, you know, it's so neat to still be learning more about the Word of God. So don't let your success and your spiritual life stop. Keep going, keep growing. And get it as an example. But the second thing that shouldn't stop us, difficulties. The difficulties were not so much with the Midianites as with the Israelites. Think about that. Not with the Midianites, but with the Israelites. Isn't that sad? You come down to chapter 8, where you find these upset people that didn't stop. Chapter 8, verse 1. Now the Ephraimites asked Gideon, now come on, how would you say this if you were an Ephraimite? Here's the way we read it in church. Why have you treated us like this? Why didn't you call us when you went to fight Gideon? Think that's how they said it? Because the next phrase says, and they challenged him vigorously. Now, you know, I heard that when I was in Israel, they said if there's two Jews, there's three opinions. And I think this is an example of this. I can just imagine this guy getting in Gideon's face and saying to Gideon, why did you treat us like this? Why didn't you call us sooner? Why did you do that? Well, what's going on now? Here you're in the middle of this battle still going on. There's still to be more to done. And you have these upset people that are saying, hey, Gideon! I think if I was Gideon, I would have said, can we talk later? Can we talk? Can we just come back to this later? Because God's, he's doing what God wants him to do. But Gideon keeps his cool. And he talks to them very wisely. Boy, you know, that's just so hard. I was a pastor. And I have scars. One down here from a board meeting, and another over here from usher's meeting, and I walk with a limp because one was the Women's Missionary Society. I think my favorite, no, it's not really a favorite, we were a larger church, approached about 1,000, you know, a lot going on. I'm walking into the auditorium, and I'm right just getting towards the auditorium, and a person, may I say, nice, an older age person stops me and says, you changed the size of the print in the bulletin. And I said, yes, we did. We made it bigger. She said, no, you didn't. You made it smaller. I said, no, we made it bigger. She said, I can look at it and tell you made it smaller. I said, I don't have time to do this right now, but I can take you in the office. We get the computer out. We get last week's bulletin, show it on size. We get this week's bulletin, show it on size. We made it bigger. A couple sitting in the back row looked at me and said, I feel sorry for you. You know, this is the moment where I'm walking in and I get so focused before I preach. I think I can say this nicely. My wife tends not to sit with me because there's no use sitting next to me because I'm like an on deck batter. The only thing I know is what I'm doing next. And she knows all my little habits that I do and just, you know, how I take my glasses off, how I clean them, I do this, I take this and that and so forth. But she's like, you know, you just have to figure out the world. Yeah, and there's just those times I've been walking in the auditorium, it's like, font's been made smaller. That's a good reason for me to lose my focus. But that's a minor example. That's a minor example. And people are the lesson for us. But there's also these other groups, this other group, the upset people didn't stop him, and the uninvolved and the uncommitted people didn't stop him either. Down to chapter 8, verses 5 and 6. And there we Give my troops some bread. They are worn out, and I am still pursuing Zebah and Zalmunna, the kings of Midian. But the fisher said, do you already have the hands of Zebah and Zalmunna in your possession? Why should we give bread to your troops? Yeah. They were fence sitters. They lacked commitment. They were asked to help. They said no. All the churches I've served, all the churches I've been to, I've never found a church that said, you know, we have too many people for the positions in this church. We were attending a church of almost 2,000. They still were recruiting people. You look around and say, oh, there's enough people to take care of it. And that can really be discouraging. That really can be discouraging. We discourage them when we're thinking about it. Here we are trying to do God's work. And when asked to help, they said no. And you see, the temptation to quit is intensified by the disconnected and the discontented and the discontented. Yeah, well, anyway, I hope you're having a slight show problem. I don't know how to even talk anymore. Wow. Here, okay, we're going to change pages and see if we get down to it. But when you think in terms about the life that we're living and how God wants us to be that kind of person, who is serving him in the way that he wants us to serve him, we need to understand that we can be a discouragement to others, and others can be a discouragement to us. You know, like, so I get involved in something, and I say, hey, I'm involved in this, and I think this is going well, and then the next thing you know, somebody comes along, and it's like there's a problem with it, and that person that's involved says, I'm out of here. Because not only can success make us think in terms of stopping, but so can discouragement. And there's one more thing that didn't stop him. The other thing that didn't stop him is in my notes, and I can't read on my computer right now. This has been a great day. This is why I teach communication. This is why sometimes I teach preaching, is to show people how not to make mistakes like this. And what I do, just in case, let me bring up the platform with me. If technology fails, which it can, do not let that discourage you. Just go back to analog. There we go. Yeah, analog. Because it takes less faith to stop a success than it does to go on to the next challenge. And the temptation to quit is intensified by the disconnected and the discontented. But the thing I want you to notice here just quietly, verses 7 and 8. Look at verses 7 and 8. Did Gideon reply, just for that, I think that's the way he said it. Just for that, when the Lord has given Zebah and Zalmunna in my hand, I will tear your flesh with desert thorns and briars. And then he goes up to Peniel, and they won't help him either. He says, when I return in triumph, I will tear down this tower. See, this time he's not keeping so under control, is he? That's kind of a hint of why we need to go one more week with the Gideon story. See the full story and see everything that's in there for us to learn. But the third thing that should not stop us, boy, I am so apologetic about this. This is not normal for me, I think you know that. But somehow I'm missing it. The third thing that should not stop us is weariness. Back to chapter 8, verse 4. I don't remember exactly the first time I read that. I have a good idea the first time it really struck me. That idea that I lived with, that Gideon and the 300, broke the pots, held up the torch, blew the horn, the battle, that was it. But that day I came to this verse, that weariness did not stop him. And weariness should not stop us. And when we look at it, it says that only when the victory was fully won, did he then return. And we do get tired. We do get tired. And we can be involved in some aspect of ministry. Doesn't have to be in the church, might be outside the church. And sometimes you hear people honored for their faith and service for so many years. You think, like, how did they keep going? How did they keep going? How did they keep going? And sometimes we just get tired. We do. And I know that one of the best counselors I got as a pastor was a businessman who said to me, you need to take 2 weeks off in a row. Said, you need 2 weeks. So So you know, I like to end with the YBH, yes but how. How are you going to become the person God wants you to be? In light of what we're talking about here. Well, the first thing is, in regard to success, I like to say it this way. If at first you do succeed, try again. Got that? If at first you do succeed, don't stop. Now, I'm a little bit counter-thinking on Psalm. Some people say, if it ain't broke, fix it. I subscribe to, if it ain't broke, fix it. Don't just leave it alone, because just because something works doesn't mean it can't work better. And that's the thing with success. Hey, that's working. Can we do it better? Hey, that's working. I can do better. I left home really confident about how this sermon was going to go. Could I have done better? Yeah. You know, next time, come back next time. We'll see if I got it better next time. But it's sometimes that dynamic is we say, hey, this is working. We're all cool. Let's just go with this. And you know, when it comes to ministry, we're in a changing culture. The way we used to talk about Jesus then, we might have to find a different way to open up those conversations. The way we serve Jesus then, we might have to find a different way. We have to look at these things and realize, yeah, just because it used to work doesn't mean it's best for today. And we more and more have to think missiologically like missionaries, because we are now dealing with having to be a counterculture ministry because we're so counter to our culture. Back in the 60s, when I wanted to be a hippie and be counterculture, my mom said no. But now I am counterculture. How about that? The culture around us has changed so much that being a follower of Christ, we're the counterculture ones now. Now about that difficulty. Here's the pastor, former pastor, saying, are you ready? Don't major on the minors. Don't major on the minors. And that's the ones that can sometimes, I'll tell you my personal opinion. When somebody says, we won't do it unless we have a unanimous vote, you realize you've given the power to control the decision to one person. Yeah, that's scary, isn't it? All it takes is one. And those things that are, where it's like people come, they got their complaints, people that we're working with, people that we're around, people in our family sometimes, they're just, I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like that. That's discouraging to us, and we can't let that be what stops us. It didn't stop getting, it shouldn't stop us. And regarding that weariness, simple phrase, I went to college today, keep on keeping on. You keep on keeping on. Now you got to take care of it, you can rest, you find that example of Jesus. But it's kind of like those 2 weeks off, brought me back refreshed so that I can then pick back up again. It's a great thing that our Constitution says that our pastors, on a periodically rotating basis, are given a sabbatical up to 3 months. In 3 months, they can totally unwind. And over 3 months, believe me, they can really unwind at that time. And then come back with renewed energy, renewed vision, renewed strength. Because that weariness is exactly what it says it does. It makes us weary. We want to keep on keeping on and not just become this trooper that's like, I'm going to do it, no matter how tired I am, though. Take care of the servant. And you're the servant, just like I'm the servant up here. We're all ministers. Did you know that? We're all ministers. Paul said God gave the church pastors and teachers to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. So we wouldn't put a signboard out there that says, minister, and then put Dennis's name or Jason's name or Marcella's name on there. We put a sign up there that says, minister to all the members. And you do get weary sometimes. We find that way to refresh, and we keep on going. You know, I think about people that decide to study karate. When they decide to go to be a karate person, they join a, they go to a place where they teach karate, over one, a little bit south of here. And they say the hardest decision in karate is the decision to actually start taking the lessons. And when you start to take the lessons, you get a gi and you get a white belt. Then you get your white belt. Now imagine walking down the street really late one night, and somebody coughs on the street, and they're there to bug you. And so you just kind of step back like this, and you go, listen, I'm going to tell you right now, I have a white belt in karate. Yeah, I think so. Now, on the other hand, when that person stands there, they're probably not going to, they just go very quiet and say, listen, I have a black belt. And that's kind of like a different story. You know the difference between a black belt and a white belt? The difference between the two? The only difference is this. A black belt is a white belt who's kept learning. Right? A understand some of these other things, and you keep growing in your faith, and you keep living, and you're doing what God wants, because God said you are predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. All of us have a ways to go in that. None of us are close to being totally like Jesus. And see, we have to stay on that process. At some point, we might experience some spiritual success. I got some prayers answered. This is doing pretty good. And God said, no, keep going. Keep going. And maybe somebody, they have an argument with you about something or disagree about something. You say, man, I don't know if I really want to hang around these guys. No, God says, keep going. Keep going. And one day you say, God, I'm just so tired. I need a break. God says, figure out how to take care of yourself. And keep going. Keep going. Because the ultimate goal is for you and for me. Become more like Jesus. Become the person God wants us to be. And so I'm just going to say one last phrase. Here's the whole message. Don't quit. Got it? Don't quit. God, I thank you for this example, Katie. Oh, we miss so much. We always just talk about the 300 and the torches. I mean, that's an important part of the whole account. You put it there. That's an important one. Love the presentation class. We will challenge others. And then to realize, hey, there is more to the story. What a basic story it is. It challenges us to not let anything stop us.